Good morning and welcome to our service of morning prayer today in our beautiful memorial garden. As we move through the season of spring and graduations from college and high school, we want to pause today to acknowledge our high school seniors from St. Peter's in the Woods who are graduating. And during our prayers of the people, we will hold them up especially. But I do invite you to be celebrating and praying with Sergey and Mary Beth and Kieran and Kennedy as we mark this important milestone in their lives of graduating from high school. So join us as we pray and celebrate with them. Today, I'm grateful for the sermon of the Right Reverend Porter Taylor, who is a new assisting bishop in the Diocese of Virginia, on this Trinity, for his words as he helps us reflect on the meaning of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, God in community in our lives. If you are tuning in early enough, please be sure to join us for our adult forum beginning at 10 as we continue looking at Barbara Taylor's book, Altar in the World, perfect as we look around this beautiful space, and at 11 for our coffee hour on Zoom. So let us pause for a moment and prepare our hearts for worship.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips,
and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee. Kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The psalm for today is a portion of Psalm 104. O Lord, how manifold are your works! In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Yonder is the great and wide sea, with its living things too many to number, creatures both small and great.
There move the ships, and there is that Leviathan, which you have made for the sport of it.
All of them look to you to give them their food in due season.
You give it to them, they gather it. You open your hand, and they are filled with good things.
You hide your face, and they are terrified. You take away their breath, and they die and return to their dust. You send forth your spirit, and they are created. And so you renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in all his works.
He looks at the earth, and it trembles. He touches the mountains, and they smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will praise my God while I have my being.
May these words of mine please him. I will rejoice in the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Hallelujah.
A reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order. Listen to my appeal. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. The word of the Lord.
Glory to you, Lord God of our fathers. You are worthy of praise. Glory to you. Glory to you.
A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age." The word of the Lord.
Grace you in peace from God our Creator and our Savior Jesus Christ. Today is Trinity Sunday, one of the major feast days in the church. And yet, to some degree, the Trinity remains a mystery. There's probably a reason for this. In the back of the prayer book on page 864, in the Creed of St. Athanasius, it says, "The Father incomprehensible, the Son incomprehensible, the Holy Ghost incomprehensible." In addition, St. Augustine said, "If you don't believe in the Trinity, you will lose your soul, but if you try to understand it, you will lose your mind." So how can we deal with this mystery in a way that enables us to keep our souls and not lose our minds? Well, to do so, we must remember why the Trinity matters to us. It's because we're made in the image of God. That means the Trinity is also about what it means for us to be disciples. To follow Jesus is to live a Trinitarian life. So instead of thinking of the Trinity as a word puzzle or a Zen koan, maybe we need to think of it as a reminder of our calling. Therefore, as we become more and more faithful to who we are, we grow into a greater sense of God's eternal nature and who we are meant to be. It's why St. Augustine would hold up the host at the Eucharist and would say, "Behold who you are, become what you see." The Trinity is not a mind game. It's not a vehicle for analogies like three-leaf clovers. It's the eternal triangle that is the DNA of the world. God is the Creator, the Mother Father, the Beloved, the Source. God is the Redeemer, the Son, the Lover, the Word made flesh, the Friend. And God is the Sanctifier, the Spirit, love itself, the wind that transforms and unifies. Rowan Williams writes, "The Trinity provides the root and energy of our being disciples here and now." So what does it mean for us in a world filled with disease and quarantine and yet another killing of an unarmed black man in our streets? How do we go from a theological concept to being disciples? And can we believe that the Trinity has anything to do with healing our country from the racism which not only infects us, but takes away lives? Well, I think a contemporary translation of today's gospel reading helps. Jesus says to the disciples, "Go and train everyone you meet far and near in this way of life, marking them by baptism in the threefold name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then instruct them in the practice of all I have commanded you. I will be with you to do this day after day, right up to the end of the age." This passage reminds us that the Trinity is not a geometrical formula. It's about discipleship. It's about being trained in this way of life. So to follow Jesus is not merely to get the words right, nor to affirm that the creed is correct. To follow Jesus is a way of seeing, a way of behaving. The early theologians came up with the doctrine of the Trinity in order to understand how to live a Christian life, which is a Trinitarian life. Therefore, we're called to embrace the Trinity as the way and to learn to go out and train everyone we meet far and near in this way of life by living it. So, what does that look like? First, it means falling in love with the living God and recognizing that the divine one who created heaven and earth is closer to you than your own breath and loves you beyond your conception, just as God loves everyone and all races, God the Creator. It's giving thanks for all of creation, including your body and this world, which means an end to violence to all citizens, but especially to black men being killed in our streets, God the Son. It means listening to the creative force of the Spirit that calls you to be an agent of justice, reconciliation, and compassion, and to believe in change. Instead of the inequity between our races, to believe that the beloved community can become near, God the Spirit. This is the practice Jesus gives the disciples to do, day after day, even to the end of the age. But remember the beginning words of the Great Commission: go out and train everyone you meet, everyone. Now, I can't actually see you, so I imagine, though, that you are thinking, this is nice, this is sweet, but what does it mean for me? Well, I thought of a lot of stories of Christian heroes as illustrations. I thought of Ruby Bridges, of Jonathan Daniels, of Betty Williams, of Martin Luther King Jr., and on and on and on. But too often we see these figures as sort of larger than life, so I want to offer an example from a different religion, a faithful Jew, who will give us a picture of what it means to train someone in this way of life. On a Sunday morning in 1991, Jewish cantor Michael Weiser and his wife Julie had just moved to Lincoln, Nebraska. They were unpacking their boxes when the phone rang, and a voice said, "You'll be sorry you moved into 1510 Randolph Street, Jew boy." 2 days later, a package was thrown against her door with pictures of Hitler and the Holocaust. Cantor Weiser called the police, and they said they thought it was the work of Larry Trapp, who was the Grand Dragon of the local KKK. Larry Trapp was suspected of firebombings in Omaha. Sometime later, Larry Trapp put up a program on the local access channel promoting white supremacy. Michael Weiser was angry, but he called Larry Trapp and told his answering machine that, you know, Hitler put to death anyone who was handicapped since Larry Trapp was in a wheelchair with diabetes. And therefore, he asked, "Why are you promoting Hitler?" And then the next day, Cantor Weiser called again and called again, and he kept calling him. Finally, Larry Trapp answered the phone. When he asked Cantor Weiser what he wanted, he said, "I thought you might need a hand with something, and I wondered if I could help you." Larry Trapp was stunned. He said, "That's nice of you, but don't call anymore." Instead, Cantor Weiser kept calling and kept calling. Finally, Larry Trapp answered the phone and told the rabbi, "I want to get out, but I don't know how." Michael Weiser told his wife about this, and she said, "Go to see him and take a peace offering." And she gave him a silver ring to take with him. When Cantor Weiser got to Larry Trapp's house, the KKK Grand Dragon burst into tears. He had on his fingers two rings with swastikas on them, and he took them off. And he said to Cantor Weiser, "I want you to take these rings. They're just a symbol of hatred and evil." And instead, he took the silver ring from Cantor Weiser and put it on his finger. After that, Larry Trapp resigned all of his racist organizations, and he wrote apologies to the people he had denounced. When he became terminally ill, he moved in with the Weisers, and Julie Weiser quit her nursing job to take care for him. Before Larry Trapp died, he became a Jew. Now, translate this story of two faithful Jews into our calling as Christians. Do we train everyone we meet in this Christian way of life by extending ourselves? Does the eternal truth of God, the incarnated example of Jesus, and the never-ending creative unifying wind of the Spirit move us to instruct people in the practice as Jesus has commanded us? Can those we meet know we are Christians by what we do instead of just what we say? When we witness racism in our cities, in our towns, do we reach across the divide? Do we become agents of change like Cantor Weiser? Do we give hope for those in fear or mourning from COVID-19? The risen Christ sends us out to make disciples in the name of the Trinitarian God. But let us remember what that means. It's not about getting someone to sign off on the catechism or the creed, because it's not a head thing. It's a way of life thing. It's a heart thing. To make disciples is to be a disciple. It's to have a Trinitarian way of life connected to God the Creator, Jesus, the incarnate one among us, and the Spirit who blows in a new creation. So my brothers and sisters, the risen Christ sends us out today, just as those early followers were sent out centuries ago, to train others in this way of life, to bring them into the body through water and the Holy Spirit, and to teach them the practices of following Jesus by showing them what a Trinitarian life looks like, which is to become an agent of God's reign of peace and justice and mercy. And let us remember what the risen Christ says to them and says to us, "I will be with you always, even to the end of the age."
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Turn to the tasks before us this day.
Fill us, gracious Lord.
In making faithful choices, great and small,
guide us, gracious Lord.
As we seek to notice and respond to those in need,
teach us, gracious Lord.
And as we offer our lives to you,
hear us, gracious Lord.
With our hearts ready to serve,
Accompany us, gracious Lord.
Almighty and everlasting God, you have given to us your servant's grace by the confession of a true faith, to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity, and in the power of your divine majesty to worship the unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith and worship, and bring us at last to see you in your one and eternal glory, O Father, who with the Son and the Holy Spirit live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but may remember that we are ever walking in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Let us pray for those in our congregation and community. For the departed soul of Katie, Betsy Marcelin's friend, for healing and recovery, Barbara, mother of Stacy Remick Simpkins, Shelby, sister of Stacy Remick Simpkins, Mary, Ann, Keir, family of Bart McMillan, Mike, brother-in-law of Christy Donovan. We continue to pray for Kathy, mother-in-law of Jennifer O'Rourke, Debbie, Darren, and Musgrove family, friend of Kathleen Keebler, Robin, friend of Kathleen Keebler, Liam, nephew of Kristen Rumrill, Megan, daughter of Tracy O'Malley, Paris, grandson of Beverly and Joe Rogue, Tottenhoff family, friends of Mary Beth and Chris Brown, Lisa, sister-in-law of Stephanie Bianco, Bishop Susan, Ronald and Nancy, parents of Allison Hall, Judy, mother of Jennifer O'Rourke, Doreen, sister of Don Mensch, Mary Beth, Robin Michael's sister, Betty, Karen Lund's mother, Rand, Gary Walsh and Beck's friend. For those in our parish, Mike, Maeve, Desiree, Karen, David, Stephanie, Jack, Bruce, Bob. We pray for all of those who have died of COVID-19, for the sick and their families, for all who mourn and are afraid. We pray for healthcare workers, researchers, and scientists, civic leaders, and all whose job put them in harm's way during this time. Let us pray for George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and all who have died in racial violence. We pray for wisdom and peace in our country. Let us commit ourselves to the way of love for the healing of our nation. For those celebrating birthdays, David McLean, Jean Prochet, Monica Clark, Sergey Hall, Luke Blasey. For our high school seniors from St. Peter's in the Woods who are graduating, Sergey Hall, Kieran Costello, Kennedy Jones, Mary Beth Lannon. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Amen.
God of our beginnings, we thank you for the gifts of these graduates, for Sergey, Mary Beth, Kieran, and Kennedy, their excitement, their awesome wonder and curiosity. We have become a richer community because of them. As they step forward into the world that awaits, comfort any fears with the knowledge of your divine presence. Strengthen them to walk in the footsteps of Jesus as modern-day disciples in a world that needs their spirit. Guide their feet as they move through life, protecting them from any pitfalls of darkness, while they help to lead future generations into the warmth and promise of your light. We ask this blessing upon each of them, in the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel with us. So be quick to love and make haste to be kind. And the blessing of God, who loves you, be upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.